following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
Without freedom of the press, no democratic form of government could exist.
We switch you now to London.
I'm standing on a rooftop looking out over London.
Good night and good luck.
Good evening from our CBS newsroom in New York.
NBC presents Chet Huntley and David Brinkley.
From ABC, this is World News Tonight. With Peter Jennings in London, Max Robinson in Chicago, and from our desk in Washington, Frank Reynolds.
Good evening.
This historic legislation, the telecommunications law, will create many, many high wage jobs, will create opportunity and better lives for all Americans.
When the press is free, the people of a country are free. When the press is not free, the people of a country are in danger of slavery.
Keeping you informed with information, news, and the views of people making the news. It's the Nicole Sandler Show on NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
Manafort's a tough guy. He seems like a tough guy. But I'm sure he's a little worried. One person who's apparently not worried about Mueller's investigation is Donald Trump. For over a year now, his catchphrase has been no collusion.
There was no collusion at all.
No collusion, no nothing. No collusion, no nothing.
No collusion.
No collusion.
No collusion.
No collusion.
He uses it for every occasion. It's like his aloha. It means both hello and I'm guilty. Uh-huh. But he... Aloha. Aloha. But he and his team have recently rebranded and are using a new phrase that Trump tweeted out this morning. Collusion is not a crime. But that doesn't matter because there was no collusion except by Crooked Hillary and the Democrat. Okay, so collusion isn't a crime, but it doesn't matter because he didn't do it anyway. Hillary did. It's really going to complicate the chance at his rallies. Lock her up, but collusion's not a crime. So what are we locking her up for? I am confused. We're living in a web of lies. But, woo, 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 woo.
Woo. All right, a little bit of Stephen Colbert to get us going. It's Wednesday. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, in addition to Wednesday... I gotta say this because it's part of me now. Today's August 1st, and it is also World Lung Cancer Day. World Lung Cancer Day, and August. Today is the 1st of August. On August 30th, that's my second anniversary of my surgery for lung cancer. So 2 years of being cancer free. So, you know, I'll use this time to just say, if you ever smoked, hopefully you don't still smoke, but if you ever smoked, now is a good time to get a scan. Go get checked out. Look, I quit smoking, I don't know, 20 years ago, more than 20 years ago. Smoked when I was much younger, for about, I don't know, 10 or 15 years, and never in a million years thought I would get lung cancer. So just when you least expect it, you know? So do go get checked out. It is World Lung Cancer Day. So remember those who've died too soon from lung cancer. Okay. I don't even know where to begin. There's a lot going on. Let me pull up all my my sound and... stuff. I'm a bit thrown off by that. I don't know why. So Trump is on the warpath again. Oh, I know what I wanted to tell you about. Because I don't have this in What's News. But he tweeted, you know, what's his name? Mueller. Yes, special counsel Robert Mueller said a few days ago that he's looking into Trump's tweets for evidence of obstruction. Well, he did it today. Donald Trump is such a moron that he doesn't realize that his tweets prove that he's at least attempting obstruction of justice. So here's what he tweeted this morning. between 9:24 and 9:34. This is a terrible situation, and Attorney General Jeff Sessions should stop this rigged witch hunt right now before it continues to stain our country any further. Bob Mueller is totally conflicted, and his 17 angry Democrats that are doing his dirty work are a disgrace to USA. Paul Manafort worked for Ronald Reagan, Bob Dole, and many other highly prominent and respected political leaders. He worked for me for a very short time. Why didn't government tell me that he was under investigation? These old charges have nothing to do with collusion. A hoax! So he's telling Jeff Sessions to stop the so-called rigged witch hunt right now. Two of Trump's lawyers today, though, said Trump was not ordering Sessions to take any specific actions. He's just expressing his opinion. Rudy Giuliani said, I think it's very well established. The president uses tweets to express his opinion. He very carefully used the word should. Boy, now we're talking semantics, huh? It just goes on. Susan Collins said it was entirely inappropriate and intemperate for Trump to make such a request of Sessions. Nice of her to get that, come out and say that. Of course, she's still going to continue doing his bidding. So what good does that do? Richard Blumenthal said Trump's tweets today could help build a case of obstruction of justice against him. It seems even more vivid in serious evidence of criminal intent to obstruct justice. Whether it is obstruction itself or not, it certainly indicated intent, Blumenthal said. There is now highly credible evidence that the president of the United States is committing obstruction of justice in real time right before our eyes. I have no doubt that the U.S. Department of Justice is going to do its job, and the special counsel is going to persevere with undiminished dedication. Okay. Dianne Feinstein said Trump's tweets indicated to her that he's very worried about Mueller's investigation. It's not a secret, she said. I think he'd like to kill the Mueller investigation any way he can, but I hope this country and particularly its representatives will not follow that. So, you know, it's Wednesday. It's another day ending with a Y, where Trump tries to obstruct justice. His attorneys push back on it. Democrats say, yeah, he's trying to obstruct justice. And we sit here and wait for Robert Mueller to do the right thing. By the way, Trump later tweeted that Manafort's being treated worse than Al Capone. Ay, ay, ay. Yeah, I guess he was on a Twitter tangent this morning. Looking back on history, who was treated worse? Alphonse, spelled wrong, Capone, legendary mob killer and public enemy number one, or Paul Manafort, political operative and Reagan Dole darling, now serving solitary confinement, although convicted of nothing. Where is the Russian collusion? Trump wrote. Oy. And in another tweet, after reports came out that Trump is monitoring the Manafort trial very closely, he sought to distance himself from Trump, saying, he worked for me for a very short time. Shut up. I wish he would just crawl back under his rock and go away. All right. There is a lot of news to get to today. First, let me tell you who we have coming up on the show. It's a bit of a different feel today. There's a great filmmaker. His name is Eugene Jarecki. And most of his films are documentaries. He was on the show when the house, I think it's called The House We Live In or The House I Used to Live In, came out. It was about drug abuse in America. He's done a lot on war. He's done a lot of real serious documentaries. And so when I was pitched on interviewing him for a new documentary he has out called The King, it took me a minute to decide, because I was never a big Elvis fan, just not. I'm a little younger than Elvis Presley. But then as I read more about the project, he basically uses Elvis Presley as a metaphor for the American dream, and comparing Elvis's rise and his career and then his, you know, the way his life ended, comparing that to where we are in America with you know, fat, bloated, and disgusting at the end. Maybe we're at the end of America right now. And then I found out that he got Elvis's 63 Rolls Royce and drives around the country talking to different people from all walks of life, from musicians to just regular folk living in Tupelo, Mississippi, and other places, to public figures, Dan Rather, Van Jones, actors, all kinds of people, I guess, about Elvis and life in America. So I thought, what the hell? Eugene Jarecki, I'm a fan of his. And so Eugene Jarecki is coming up at the bottom of the hour. But before we get to that, let's get to the news, shall we? I read the news today. Oh, boy.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
We'll begin today with Trump's rally in Tampa, Florida last night, where CNN reporter Jim Acosta was accosted by the crowd. At this Trump rally last night, attendees were shouting abuse at the newsman, giving him the middle finger, threatening him.
The White House closed out the month of July without holding a briefing for reporters today.
Listen to this in the background of this report.
Only three briefings for the press this month and eight total since the end of May. There is no other way to describe what the White House is doing these days. Wolf, top officials, including the president, are hiding from the press. And Wolf, just to give you a sense as to what's happening right now, you can hear there is a chorus of boos and other chants from this Trump crowd here in Tampa, Florida. They're saying things like CNN sucks, go home, and fake news. Wolf, obviously, all of those things are false. We're staying right here. We're going to do our job and report on this rally to all of our viewers here tonight, Wolf.
So while Jim Acosta's there doing a live shot, you hear the crowd screaming, CNN sucks, CNN sucks. They're giving him the finger. There were some other clips where you hear profanities being hurled. I mean, it was really nasty. In a tweet where Jim Acosta posted a short video of the kind of taunts he was getting, he wrote, "Just a sample of the sad scene we faced at the Trump rally in Tampa. I'm very worried that the hostility whipped up by Trump and some in conservative media will result in somebody getting hurt." Trump himself was his usual narcissistic self, claiming to be the most popular Republican in history, falsely citing a poll right after he claimed all polls are fake.
And all of you, who has 401ks here? I guarantee you one thing, I have your vote.
Oh, God. What a dick. He is a dick.
Of course, if the fake news did a poll, they're called suppression polls. You know, polls are fake just like everything else.
Oy.
If the fake news did a poll, it would show that I'm only getting 25% with the 401k people, even though they're up 44%. No, we're doing well. We're doing well, and I'm happy you're doing well. They just came out with a poll. Did you hear? The most popular
person. Is it a fake poll?
Person in the history of the Republican Party.
Give me a break.
Is Trump. Can you believe this?
No, I can't believe it.
So I said, does that include Honest Abe Lincoln? You know, he was pretty good,
Oh, my
right?
God. What an egomaniac.
Remember I said, when I'd be a little bit wild and would have a lot of fun, they'd say, he's not acting presidential. And I'd say, well, it's a lot easier to act presidential than to do what I do.
Oh, God. Than to be an asshole
anybody
all the time?
Anybody can act presidential.
Oh, anybody can act presidential? But nobody can be as big a dick as you are?
Ladies and gentlemen.
This is him being presidential.
Thank you very much for being here. You
and these morons
people
in the audience are sucking
and
it
I
up.
I will leave now because I am boring you to death. Thank you. No, but I said, I can be, I used to tell them all the time, the fake news, I'd say, I can be more presidential than any president in history.
No, you really can't.
Except for possibly Abe Lincoln.
No, you really can't. You don't
Abe,
have it in you. Shut up.
Right? What do you
shut
think?
Up. You don't have the intelligence. You don't have the discipline. You don't have the IQ to do anything but be the asshole you are. It was at the same rally, to prove a point, Trump tried to justify voter ID laws, proving just how out of touch he is with reality, saying you need a photo ID to buy groceries. Seriously.
In some states, Democrats are even trying to give illegal immigrants the right to vote. They want to give them the right to vote.
No, they don't. That's another lie from a habitual liar.
People that are waiting in line for 7, 8, 9, 10 years trying to get into our country, they don't have the right to vote. We believe that only American citizens should vote in American elections.
Guess what? So do we, you fucking asshole.
Which is why the time has come for voter ID, like everything else.
No, you can just compare signatures, which is the way they've always done it. And there's no voter fraud.
You know, if you go out and you want to buy groceries, you need a picture on a card.
What?
You need ID.
Since when?
You go out and you want to
Since
buy anything.
Since when?
You need ID.
Bullshit.
You need a picture.
Again, he lies because he's never been grocery shopping.
The only time you don't need it, in many cases, is when you want to vote for a president, when you want to vote for a senator, when you want to vote for a governor or a congressman. It's crazy.
He's just a liar. That's all he does. So that's all I'm going to torture you with. Facebook has found evidence of coordinated, inauthentic behavior designed to influence U.S. politics ahead of the November midterm elections. The activity could be linked to the Russian Internet Research Agency that organized a disinformation campaign ahead of the 2016 presidential vote. According to NBC, Facebook deleted the pages in question without revealing the divisive information used by the bad actors, including posts that stoked racial tension.
With less than 100 days until the midterm elections, Facebook says it's happening again. A coordinated campaign on the platform, fueling deep divisions among Americans. The social media giant now working with the FBI and others, saying it can't say for sure who's behind the latest disinformation campaign. But this morning, lawmakers insist there's no doubt who's responsible.
I can say, I think, with pretty high confidence, I think this is Russian-related.
Republican Lindsey Graham endorsing new sanctions against the Kremlin.
It'll be the sanctions bill from hell, and any other country who is trying to interfere with our election should suffer the same fate.
Facebook announcing it's removed 32 pages and accounts from Facebook and Instagram. One fake page called Resistors, promoting a counter-protest against an upcoming white nationalist rally here in D.C.
Amazing.
Encouraging real activists to bring helmets, goggles, and medical supplies in anticipation of a violent clash. That phony Resistors page also pushing the left-wing campaign to abolish ICE, the Immigration and Customs Enforcement Agency, part of a growing political firestorm. The suspicious activity running from March of last year until this May, garnering 290,000 followers.
Security is an arms race, and it's never done.
Facebook touting its quick response after a series of damaging headlines. Last week, losing $120 billion, the largest single-day loss in stock market history. All of it coming just months after CEO Mark Zuckerberg faced a congressional grilling for the company's handling of Russian interference in 2016.
Unfortunately, the enforcement isn't perfect. We do need to make it more proactive, and I'm committed to doing that.
And the president aides say aware of Facebook's latest response. Homeland Security Secretary Kirstjen Nielsen delivering this warning for any foreign power who interferes in U.S. elections.
Any attempt to interfere in our elections is a direct attack on our democracy. It is unacceptable and it will not be tolerated.
Yeah, but if Russia does it, Trump will give him an excuse or say, or it could have been someone else, too. Yeah. The trial of Trump's former campaign chairman, Paul Manafort, began yesterday. They did jury selection and jury instructions, and opening statements all in that first day. The defense argued in its opening statement that it was Manafort's longtime aide, Rick Gates, now a witness for special counsel Robert Mueller, who's the guilty party. Yes, can you say threw him under the bus? CNN has more.
President Trump's former campaign chairman Paul Manafort facing day two of his trial for alleged financial fraud after both sides laid the groundwork for what's likely to be a dramatic showdown between Manafort and his longtime deputy and the government's key witness, Rick Gates. If convicted, Manafort is facing a maximum sentence of over 300 years on 18 charges, including filing false tax returns, failing to report foreign bank accounts, and defrauding several banks. Prosecutors portraying Manafort as a, quote, shrewd liar who opened 30 bank accounts in three foreign countries to avoid paying taxes on $60 million of income from his work in Ukraine, including helping former Ukrainian president and Putin ally Viktor Yanukovych. Prosecutors arguing that the money went towards supporting Manafort's lavish lifestyle, including multiple homes, expensive cars and watches, even a $15,000 ostrich jacket. Amazing. The defense pointing the finger at Gates, arguing he was the mastermind behind the scheme who swindled Manafort. Gates is cooperating with the special counsel after pleading guilty to conspiring to defraud the United States and lying to the FBI, a fact the defense plans to use to discredit his testimony. Gates also worked for the Trump campaign, but neither the president nor the investigation into potential Russia collusion are likely to be addressed in this case. The Trump administration continuing to distance itself from Manafort.
Paul Manafort does not know anything, nor could it be possible he did. He was with him for 4 months.
Oh, Manafort has nothing to do with our campaign. Oh,
despite praising his work during the 3 months he led the president's campaign.
Paul Manafort just came on. He's great.
Sources tell CNN that publicly the White House strategy is to downplay the proceedings. But behind the scenes, the president is keeping a close eye on the trial, watching TV coverage and asking his legal team for updates.
Of course. Yeah, he's nervous. Trump, that is. All right. Moving on to the kids separated from their parents. And there was still something like over 600 children here. And there's no way to get them back together with their parents. Well, Matthew, a few of them testified yesterday before the Senate Judiciary Committee. Matthew Albence is the Executive Associate Director for Enforcement and Removal Operations for ICE. So he was defending the conditions at these immigrant detention facilities, comparing them, I kid you not, to a summer camp.
With regard to the FRCs, I think the best way to describe them is to be more like a summer camp. These individuals have access to 24/7 food and water. They have educational opportunities. They have recreational opportunities, both structured as well as unstructured. There's basketball courts, there's exercise classes, there's soccer fields that we put in there. They have extensive medical, dental, and mental health opportunities. In fact, many of these individuals, the first time they've ever seen a dentist is when they've come to one of our FRCs.
They've been taken away from their parents.
When they leave an FRC, they leave there with 7 sets of clothing for each individual that was in that FRC. While they are there, they do have all sorts of access to pro bono legal opportunities. There's a legal orientation program that is there, and they are able to avail themselves of that. There are many NGOs that work in those facilities, are there on a daily basis to provide them assistance and support once they are released back into the community. So I'm very comfortable with the level of service and protection that is being provided in the FRCs.
Makes you kind of wonder if he's ever been in one of these FRCs. They're family residential centers. Well, thankfully, Senator Mazie Hirono of Hawaii was on that committee and asked, wait till you hear this. This is mind-blowing.
Now, Mr. Albence also testified that Homeland Security's Family Residential Centers, FRCs, are like summer camps. I'd like to know whether all of the panel members are familiar with Homeland Security's FRCs. Ms. Provost.
Ma'am, I do not have a specific, I have not been to one of the FRCs.
Commander?
Ma'am, I've never visited in a family residential center. I'd have to defer to my colleague from ICE. He would know
never
best.
Never visited one.
Mr. McHenry, are you familiar?
I've never been to an FRC either.
Nope.
And what about you, Ms. Higgins?
Yes, I've been to both Dilley and to Carnes.
So since these are described as family residential centers, and I would ask this of you, Ms. Higgins, and Mr. Albence, would you send your children to these centers? Ms. Higgins.
I I certainly think that in general practice, people would prefer to be free to move about. I can tell you that the centers that I saw did, as described, have schools. And
so you would send your child to these centers?
Yes, it's very no? That's a difficult question to answer. It's difficult to put myself in the position of an individual who takes a dangerous journey. In which their child can be
harmed,
these
are deemed
let alone whether I would send
summer
my children.
Summer camps, so, you know.
Yeah. She wouldn't answer the question. That's your answer for you. Unbelievable. Now, Commander Jonathan White, he was one of the men there who said that he's never visited one of these centers. He is a top official in the Health and Human Services office that cares for migrant children. He told the senators that he had warned his superiors that separating children from their parents carried a significant risk of harm and, could inflict psychological injury.
Any member of this panel say to anyone, maybe this isn't such a good idea, Commander?
During the deliberative process over the previous year, we raised a number of concerns in the ORR program about any policy which would result in family separation due to concerns we had about the best interest of the child, as well as about whether that would be operationally supportable with the bed capacity we had.
So that was an HHS official testifying before the Senate today, asked by Senator Blumenthal, hey, did anyone there inside HHS say don't separate children from their families, don't rip them apart? And what you just saw, and I'll read this answer again, during the deliberative process over the previous year, we raised a number of concerns in the ORR program, that's part of HHS, about any policy which results in family separation due to concerns we had about the best interests of the child. In other words, absolutely we raised concerns. Absolutely we warned them not to do it. Absolutely it would be terrible for these children. And you know what the Trump administration did? They went ahead and they did it anyway.
Heads should roll over this. Somebody should go to jail. Children were kidnapped from their parents. Children are still now in government custody, in cages, in these FRCs. Oh, they're like summer camps. And there's no way to reunite them with their parents because in many cases, the parents have already been deported. Shameful. Absolutely shameful. The Republicans have been packing the courts with conservative judges at a record pace, right? After they held up Obama from making these appointments. They've been just sending them through. This is why it's so important that the Democrats take back the Senate as well as the House, because it's the Senate that confirms the judges. Mitch McConnell is keeping the Senate in session through August to continue the practice, but someone threw a wrench in his plans. MSNBC's Chris Hayes explains.
Donald Trump has been appointing judges at a record pace, pushing through the Senate more federal judges than any other recent president in his first 2 years, stacking the courts with conservatives, many of them quite young, who will remain on the bench long after Trump himself is gone. And Mitch McConnell is paving the way, calling it his top priority to get Trump's judges confirmed. McConnell even went so far as to cancel the Senate's August recess for a number of reasons, including among them confirming as many more judges as he possibly can. But now, the McConnell judge approval machine has ground to a halt because apparently one member of the Senate Judiciary Committee has gone missing. And so McConnell can't get any more nominees to the floor for a vote. One senator flew off to Zimbabwe. Jeff Flake posted this picture on Twitter the other day, writing, "Sunset this evening in rural Zimbabwe, tomorrow election day, marks a new day for this beautiful country." Flake is there observing the elections, which are the first since Robert Mugabe left. And he posted several more photos yesterday of polling stations and ballots being counted. Now, it's certainly possible this was just a really important trip to Senator Flake. He does have a connection to the country, having served part of his Mormon mission there. But he must have realized that his absence, lasting approximately 3 more weeks, according to his office, is also royally screwing over McConnell and President Trump, who need Flake in D.C. to continue their mission of packing the courts with as many conservatives as they can. And again, Jeff Flake has announced he's not running for re-election, so maybe this is his way of riding off into the sunset.
Okay, so good on Flake. I'm glad he did this. He's shown himself to be wishy-washy. You know, he talks a good game, but he keeps voting with Trump and the rest of these asshole Republicans. Because he's on the Judiciary Committee, they can't get these nominees through without him. So I think Mitch McConnell is going to let his members go on an August recess. Thank you, Jeff Flake, even though I still think you're a jerk. All right, I've got one more. It's your Fox News Shepard Smith moment of sanity for the day. I don't know how he keeps having a job, but at least they've got one sane person over there.
President Trump sending mixed signals about whether he'll shut down the government if he doesn't get funding for his border wall. The president doubling down on his threat today. He's tweeted, "Don't care what the political ramifications are. Our immigration laws and border security have been a complete and total disaster for decades. And there is no way that the Democrats will allow it to be fixed without a government shutdown. Border security is national security, and national security is the long-term viability of our country." He goes on, "A government shutdown is a small price to pay for safe and prosperous America, as if shutting down the government is going to make America safe and prosperous." I mean, laughable.
It's laughable. It is laughable. Trump keeps talking about, I hope he does shut it down, because it will be all on him. All right. Very quickly, somebody in the chat room keeps asking about Bigfoot porn or Bigfoot erotica. Very quickly, Bigfoot erotica is now a campaign issue. Leslie Coburn, that's how you pronounce it. I know it's spelled Cockburn, but it's pronounced Coburn. A Democrat vying to snag Virginia's 5th congressional district tweeted Sunday what may be one of the strangest political attacks in recent history, an accusation that her opponent, Republican Denver Riggleman, is a devotee of Bigfoot erotica. She tweeted, "My opponent, Denver Riggleman, running mate of Corey Stewart, was caught on camera campaigning with a white supremacist. Now he has been exposed as a devotee of Bigfoot erotica. This is not what we need on Capitol Hill." And she's got a drawing of Bigfoot with a censored bar over Bigfoot's penis. Who knew, right? Riggleman told Vice News that the illustrations were all just part of one big 14-year-long joke with his friends, and that to take them seriously was ridiculous, even if he did happen to co-author a book that includes the claim, "Bigfoots like sex too." There you go. You wanted Bigfoot erotica? You got Bigfoot erotica. All right. Now it's time to segue into Elvis and Trump. I'm not kidding, because there is a correlation there. Well, for that, we need to talk to the director of the movie, The King. Eugene Jarecki is an award-winning filmmaker. I had the chance to speak with him a few years ago when The House I Live In, a film about America's drug epidemic, was released. In addition to other films, including Why We Fight, Freakonomics, and others, Eugene is also the author of The American Way of War, Guided Missiles, Misguided Men, and A Republic in Peril. He's got a new film out now. It's already playing in some cities, opening here in South Florida Friday, called The King. I have to admit that when I was pitched on talking with the writer and director of a film about Elvis Presley as a metaphor for America, I was a bit skeptical. But when I heard it was Eugene Jarecki, I knew I had to see the film. And I did get to watch it yesterday. And it works. So, Eugene, first of all, welcome back to the show. Thanks so much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
What gave you the idea to do a film like this, to use Elvis Presley as a metaphor for America?
Well, I think the metaphor in many ways used me. I mean, Elvis Presley is the most inextricable figure in our history from the American dream itself. No one more strongly represents what we all hold dear, right? Which is that an everyday person in this country coming from nowhere can rise unstoppably based on their talent, based on their character, based on whatever it is about them that they want to be understood as having, the content of their self. And Elvis Presley represents that in the most beautiful way, of course. But as time goes on, you start to look at it a bit more critically, and the link between him and this country becomes more deeply poetic.
And it does work as the, you know, you go through his life. Actually, you do it by getting a hold of his old 1963 Rolls Royce. How did you come into possession of that?
Well, we never thought that we would make this cross-country road movie. We started out making a poetic film, kind of looking at Elvis as the American dream and the rise and fall of Elvis. What does that tell us about maybe the rise and fall of the American dream itself? That's all we were doing. And then one day, somebody on my staff who was working on the film crew said, "Hey, I just read online that Elvis's 1963 Rolls Royce is coming up for auction in Pebble Beach, California. I wonder if we could somehow get involved. We were like, we can't afford a car like that. We're already on a tight budget, et cetera. Then we found out that what the kind of range of numbers was, and we went to the production itself and said to the investors in the film, we have this crazy idea to make this a bigger, more amazing, more on the road kind of anything might happen road movie, while also reflecting on these sort of poetic elements. Would you be up for that? And I think based on the excitement of what might be, they stepped forward and allowed us to buy the car at auction, which the film did, with the promise that we would sell it again when we were done, and with the promise by me that I wouldn't destroy it, wrap it around a tree or drive it into the Grand Canyon. And I tried very hard not to do that.
Can I ask what you paid for it?
I can't say what we paid for it because we have sold it, and the new buyer has asked us to keep that as sort of confidential. But I can say it was surprising. Something was poetic there too, because you would think it would cost like millions of dollars.
Yeah.
Because it was like a car that day that cost like $60 million, an Italian sports car from the 60s. But it's something like that. This car was, you know, in the hundreds of thousands of dollars to buy and then to sell again. And that's a huge amount of money for everyday people. But in the car market, it told us that something about the dream, even as embodied in Elvis's most precious Rolls Royce, had faded somehow. It wasn't, you know, we weren't trying to beat out the world to buy that car. There was another guy bidding that day wearing blue suede shoes, and we were worried he was a real devotee.
Uh-huh.
But no, we were able to, and it was almost like the car was sort of like a gift from God for us. We were given it for a time in order to explore this country very poetically, with a love of Elvis, a love of the country, and a magnet for other people's thoughts and feelings and their music. Because as you know, people play music in the back of the car throughout the film.
Oh, yes.
And then off it went again. And it's now in the hands of other people. And it was very poetic the way we sold it as well.
It was kind of poetic in that it broke down a few times along the way.
Yes, and it depends on what you think that means. You know, I mean, if you think of the car in the wrong way, I think you would say, well, Eugene is saying that the American dream is breaking down or something. Mm-hmm. That's not really what it says to me. I don't believe that people like Elvis Presley should buy Rolls-Royce cars.
Right.
Rolls-Royce is a car associated with the King of England. Last I checked, we broke off from England to start this country, and we did not believe in kings and queens and royalty. This place was supposed to be of the people, by the people, for the people. So when I see Elvis in a, you know, in a General Motors chrome, you know, candy colored Thunderbird or Cadillac from the golden age, sure, that looks and feels like the American dream. Now that has its own problems, and we can talk about that. But the Rolls Royce is a whole other animal. And David Simon, the creator of The Wire, when he gets in the car in the film, he says to me, why didn't you buy one of his Cadillacs?
Right.
And he suddenly understands, oh, I see what you're doing. You're dealing with the poetry of the demise of Elvis, of what happened to Elvis. Really, of what power and money in Vegas, for example, did to Elvis, and that's what's happening to America. Yep, that's why we did the car.
I see. You mentioned musicians get in the back and play in the car, and it's a wonderful aspect of the movie. I'm a huge John Hyatt fan, and he's one of the first faces you see at the beginning of the film get in. But later on, when you actually do a segment with John Hyatt, he breaks down in tears. What was that reaction about?
Well, what was interesting was it was very early on in the filmmaking process, and any movie maker that doesn't confess to some insecurity about what they're doing either knows something I don't know or they're lying. Because I go through every movie like in personal therapy, where I'm constantly asking myself, is this a stupid idea? Am I on the wrong track? Am I on a road to nowhere? John was early in the process. And you can imagine when a legendary country rocker gets into the back of Elvis's car in my movie, and I'm busy futzing with some broken knob up in the front seat, and I suddenly look back to start the interview, and he's bawling like a child. I said, is there something I said? And he goes, not at all. It's just getting in this car and feeling all the weight that Elvis must have felt, this boy king who should never have been a king because he was a country boy. And now he's got the trappings of power and the trappings of royalty, and it's soul-crushing. And John just weeps in the back, and then he pulls it together and does an incredible version of his song, The Wind Don't Have to Hurry. And it's really heartbreaking.
Yeah.
But it gave me affirmation. It was so early in the process. It gave me affirmation, I guess, that I was on the right idea, that if it was going to move somebody like him to tears, it was going to mean something across the country and the world.
Right. You have. We're speaking with Eugene Jarecki about his new film, The King, which opens in South Florida on Friday. It's playing in theaters around the country. You have a wide variety of people, not only musicians. I see Roseanne Cash is one of the executive producers on the film. So a lot of musicians. You spend a good amount of time, and you start out in Tupelo, where Elvis started, and you move to Memphis and Nashville, and then head out to L.A. and go across the country in this 1963 Rolls Royce with different people. But there's also some political figures. You have James Carville and Van Jones in there. You have actors, Mike Myers and Ethan Hawke and Ashton Kutcher. What was the criteria for getting someone to participate?
Well, everywhere we went was a place that was relevant to Elvis's timeline, the timeline of his life. So we start out in Tupelo, where he's born. We travel to Memphis, where Elvis becomes Elvis. He's marinated in Black culture, and he mm-hmm. becomes a conduit for Black music as a white person to the world. And then that brings him to Nashville, where there's Black-white tension, and he sort of gets his music, gets the rock and roll kind of beat knocked out of it, and it becomes a little more ready for the masses. And then, boom, he explodes in New York, and his signal is beamed out to millions and millions, and he'll never be the same again. And so each chapter of his life is there. And what we wanted in each place was to have people who were key to understanding that place today or that place back then with Elvis. Because the movie is a tour through contemporary America through the lens of the past that Elvis represents. It's almost like, what if Mozart landed on the planet today and looked around and listened to hip hop? And this thing, you're like, what would the world look like from back then, and how does back then differ from now? So we wanted people who would bridge these eras. They would be in the present, but you could feel the past haunt the present. They would tell you what it's like in New York right now, what New York represents to the world, what it meant in Elvis's time. So New York's a classic example, because there's Alec Baldwin in New York, who he's got some of the same struggles as Elvis in terms of his popularity coming and going, his weight coming and going, mm-hmm. his love life on public display. He's been sort of loved and reviled. Like, he's a similar kind of hot, he's not Elvis, nobody's Elvis, but he's a similar person in that he's a huge celebrity who's had his struggles, and he's sitting in New York knowing everything about what it takes to make it or break it in New York. But in the same section, you've got Dan Rather, right, who came to New York when Elvis did, also a country boy, also suddenly having his signal, Dan Rather, beamed out to millions, where he becomes the voice of America. And so there's this always in each place. Ashton Kutcher is in L.A. We're talking to Ashton Kutcher about fame and what it might have done to Elvis. And every 30 seconds, our conversation is interrupted by one of those look at the stars homes vehicles mm-hmm. that they drive around L.A., basically sniping at celebrities. And it's not like, oh, cry me a river, Ashton Kutcher, you're so famous. But it is kind of unbelievable to be with someone who cannot get a sentence out without strangers yelling, "We love you. Say hi to Mila."
Right, right.
And he doesn't know these people. And he's very kind with them. But it's and I'm not there again. Fame is something people elect to have. But what Ashton points out is how crushing it must have been for Elvis to be the first person that everyone was watching 24 hours a day. And so every move you make is suddenly examined and questioned. And there's a huge amount of pressure on, again, a country boy to be the first and to represent America moving into the modern era in which we now exist, where everything is in public, everything is pressed upon, everything is a product.
Right. You go through, his history, which coincides with American history, and you don't whitewash the fact that Elvis, came up. Somebody calls him a racial appropriator, talking mm-hmm. about how he basically stole Black music. I think Van Jones and Chuck D were both among the more critical of Elvis. I came a little after Elvis. I was raised on the Beatles more than Elvis. There is a big hole sort of during the civil rights era when Elvis returned from fighting, from the war, he didn't join the civil rights movement.
Listen, I think Chuck D puts the clearest, finest point on this in the film. Chuck D is an international treasure. He's brilliant in the film, and I was so honored to have him. Mm-hmm. One of the things he says, and it's really because his intellect is just amazing, and one of the things he says that's so precise is, I never accused Elvis of being a racist and fight the power because he played Black music. I like that he played Black music. We should all play each other's music. We should all share culture. That's what would make the world richer, more cooperative, more peaceful. So that's to be celebrated, that Elvis had the courage in a 1950s time frame to be a white guy sounding like a black person is amazing. We praise Eminem for it today. Elvis did it 60 years ago, and mm-hmm. it's pretty incredible that he did. But what then becomes a question is what the white music industry does in the appropriation of black music as a matter of profit seeking. That basically, sure, Elvis plays music like a black person, kinda, but he rises into international stardom with it, incredible fame and fortune, while the black people on whom his music is in large part based, they don't get to be the king. They don't get those accolades, and they don't become the heroes that a young Chuck D is taught to look up to. He's told that his heroes don't matter, and our heroes, meaning white America's heroes, matter more. And that's a racism that's systemic that Chuck D saw Elvis as symbolic of. The idea that Elvis then goes into the civil rights movement, that's where it gets further complicated about him, the man, where Chuck D and Van Jones then agree, because they disagree about racial appropriation. Chuck is much more sort of supportive of this idea of cultural sharing. Van Jones comes across as, listen, my father lived in Memphis, and this theft just hurt the feelings of black America enormously. And that's a valid position. But by the time they get to the civil rights movement, he and Chuck both say, we understand that Elvis was so helped by the black community coming up and having his music so shaped by black America. But where was Elvis when black America needed every bit of help they could get in the civil rights movement? And they got it from Marlon Brando, from mm-hmm. Jane Fonda, from Harry Belafonte, but they didn't quite get it from Elvis Presley, who at that point is a huge megastar. And when asked about political matters, he basically demurs and says, oh, I don't think a celebrity should talk about that kind of thing.
Yeah. You don't have the part, you don't have the picture of Elvis visiting Richard Nixon in the film, but that's something that, you know, we look back on and wonder if he were still alive today, where Elvis would fall politically. There is the backdrop. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, it's super quick, but you actually do have a shot of him meeting with Nixon.
Oh,
and it happens only, it's just that it happens during a kind of a joke by Mike Myers, who's incredibly funny in the film. And what Mike Myers says is that Elvis wanted to be the drug czar. And it's in that meeting with Nixon that he shakes hands with him and wants to be the drug czar. And then Mike Myers says, let me get this straight. Elvis, an inveterate drug user, wants to be the drug czar. Might this go in the irony Hall of Fame?
Right. Okay. So that was there. I wonder where Elvis might have been politically today, because that he did not get political as many did. I mean, juxtapose him with Muhammad Ali.
I don't want to speak for him, but if you look at Elvis's friendships, if you look at his view of the world, if you listen to In the Ghetto and other songs that Elvis clearly cared about, and if you notice that he has nothing in his oeuvre that is racist, sexist, chauvinistic, or patronizing of the other, I think you would find that Elvis is a progressive person. And I know sort of maybe right-wing America may not want to hear that, because with the passage of time, the right wing clings to the hope that big white men will continue to run this country. And the picture of somebody like Elvis being the king sort of fits that. But I don't think Elvis would have felt that way. And I can't speak for the man. I can only read his career, which was, you know, he was profoundly close friends with African-American artists, African-American luminaries. He was incredibly involved at a personal level in the African-American experience and in the experience of poverty in America. He took great care in a way that I think right-wing people would think was welfare. He took great care of people, helped them, helped the people who worked for him, helped other people who didn't have work. This is a guy who was a New Dealer, far more than somebody who believed in trickle down. And one need say no more about it than that. His career speaks for itself.
Right. The specter, I suppose, of Donald Trump does show up throughout the film. Thankfully, it's not overpowering. But obviously, as you're on this road trip in Elvis's 1963 Rolls Royce going across the country, it was during the 2016 presidential campaign. It's now being it's released a year and a half into Donald Trump's hopefully only term as president, in something that has become this, you know, bad dystopian movie that, you know, had someone submitted a script like this would never have gotten made because it's too unfeasible. How does Donald Trump play into this? How does he connect with Elvis?
I would say that Donald Trump represents in one single person the embodiment of everything that destroyed Elvis Presley. Mm. He is the enemy of everything that Elvis stood for and that Elvis represents in terms of the hopes of the American dream, the hopes of working people, the fraternity among people, kindness, authenticity, purity. So he's also the embodiment of everything that threatens to destroy this country if this country does not have a move back toward democracy and away from capitalism. Donald Trump is simply what you get when you let capitalism run roughshod over your democracy.
So Donald Trump is sort of the metaphor for you know, the caricature of Elvis that we always see, him in the, you know, fat, bloated, sweating in the white jumpsuit.
No, I don't think that's fair.
No?
I don't think that's right. I think it's the opposite. I think Elvis, when he's that fat, I know there's a, you know, because Trump has funny hair or because he's overweight or whatever,
right.
But that should be kept very, very separate. Trump is the sort of monster that destroys the young Elvis and turns him into the Elvis he becomes. But Trump remains outside this equation. We were once in Manchester, New Hampshire, and I was told that the candidate wanted to ride in the Rolls Royce when we were there during the convention. And I prevented that from happening because I believe that a figure of that toxicity that I think history will see as one of history's most horrendous demagogues, I think that that person has no business being near Elvis Presley's machine. And I want to keep it that way, but there's no question that the forces that that the current president represents are forces that destroyed Elvis and that really do threaten this country. That they, you know, that they look similar is as interesting as Charlie Chaplin looking similar to Hitler. It's just an accident of optics.
I see. Well, that I see. But is the, you know, if I even have it right, that the rise and fall of Elvis is sort of a metaphor for America as he was coming up, and it was the, you know, just the time in the 50s when people were doing well, and you know, the 68 comeback special, you have Elvis in great form, and now here we are still mired in these wars, although the economy on paper looks to be doing well today. There are other things that say this is a temporary thing based on, you know, a lot of companies trying to get in before the trade wars take off. Where are we in the stage of Elvis's life, do you think, right now in American history?
Well, when the current president entered the Oval Office, I thought that the metaphor of the film might suggest that we had indeed died on the toilet as a country, the way that Elvis had at age 42. And I was petrified about where this was going. And many people who spoke to me at the time of the election told me that they were petrified too, but that they thought it was really good for my movie, which was a really macabre thought, that the worse the world gets, the more my analysis of what's wrong would hold true. But I've watched something incredible happen in the year or so since I first was finishing the movie for the Cannes Film Festival until now. And what I learned in the meantime is look at all the things that have risen up in resistance to this moment in the Oval Office, in response to how Washington, A, in response to him, and B, in response to how Washington is permitting him to ransack so much that Americans hold dear. What has risen is some of the most significant social movements in my lifetime. Me Too, Time's Up, the Poor People's Movement, the Parkland students rising up against the NRA, sanctuary city protections instituted by mayors, governor uprisings, people standing up in the streets to defend immigrants from a rapacious and fascistic central government, the incredible outcry when this administration started to institute what were effectively concentration camps for children on American soil. The worse it gets, the more you see people wake up, that idea of woke. And I mean, just to say the success of Black Panther and Wonder Woman only could have happened on the watch of somebody so chauvinistic, so rapacious, and so racist. And it's in reaction to that that we're watching real glimmers of democracy. So where we are right now, I think, is in a remarkable rebound period. And it relies on all of us to decide what role we're planning to play in that and whether we are going to be part of the solution or part of the continued affliction that we have been suffering from, an affliction that blossomed into the current president, administration, and Congress, but it's been long in the making because we let it go too long.
Right. Right. Well, we have a chance to do something in just over 3 months with Election Day, and hopefully...
But you have a chance to do it every day. People can't wait for Election Day. They've got to be active, active, mm-hmm. active right now at the level of strikes and protests. One of the things I didn't mention in the list of amazing social developments is the teacher strikes that just saw in red states.
Yep.
Several red states where teachers struck to get better conditions for those who teach our children, for crying out loud. You know, we used to honor teachers and firefighters and policemen. And now what do? Cut their hours, cut their pay, cut their benefits. It's not the right. It's not the American dream. It's capitalism running amok and hijacking the American dream for its profit. Do you know that Jeff Bezos of Amazon, the head of Amazon, mm-hmm. makes $1.2 million an hour?
Oh, God.
And did you know that Amazon did not pay any federal tax in 2017?
I did know that.
If your listeners hear that, look it up, mm-hmm. confirm it,
yep,
then
true.
Get out into your life and stop and protest that kind of highway robbery. And then we'll be dumped. That's like dumping tea in the ocean. That's how this country was started. And if you want to live in this country the way that we care about it, it is through an engaged citizenry. It isn't through sitting back and watching it all unfold on Facebook.
You know, Eugene Jarecki, you've done a lot of work dealing with war from the book that I mentioned to, of course, Why We Fight. Does Donald Trump's his warmongering, his tweeting, I mean, his all caps threat to Iran just the other day, does that worry you?
It should worry anybody that at a time where this country needs massive international cooperation to solve problems that we face that are truly global problems, from global warming to immigration, meaning the refugee phenomenon in the world that is related to global warming, mm-hmm. to international poverty, to disease, to the risk of pandemics, to the increasing volatility of weather and its consequences on economic security and political terms, at a time where we need to work together with everybody to achieve that kind of thing, to have somebody who can't even keep people employed in his administration, who constantly changes his mind on every issue and is a laughingstock to the world. I've toured the world like crazy with this film. He, and by extension, we have become a laughingstock. And when you have a laughingstock where you once had FDR, where you once had Eisenhower, where you once had John F. Kennedy, where you once, you know, you're Ronald Reagan, for crying loud, you're now in a position where you have a clown who has very self-serving motivations and the emotional intellect of a child, of a 12 or 13 year old person. Yeah. That should worry anyone. At the same time, what I would say to you is I like the fact that he's there waking people up, because as long as he doesn't finger on the button, blow us all to smithereens, I think it's a glimpse for Americans of how wildly out of control this system has become and what it's like when you let power and money loose to run through your vegetable garden. They'll gobble up and dig up everything. And that's what's happening right now. And it teaches you why regulation matters. It teaches you why capitalism unregulated destroys democracy. Mm-hmm. And when capitalism is regulated, as it was under FDR, as it was under Eisenhower and others, it works.
You seem to leave the film on an optimistic note. It's towards the end of Elvis's life. He is in the white jumpsuit. He's not looking good. He's overweight. He's sweating. But then he sits down at the piano and he plays and sings a remarkable version of Unchained Melody. Is that your way of saying that maybe the American dream is not dead?
Yes. And I think that in the eyes of Elvis Presley, in that extraordinary final song, you see the same eternal flame of the American spirit, of the human spirit, anywhere in the world, on our grand and long quest, as Ronald Reagan said, from the swamp to the stars. And Elvis Presley is one of the sort of long-distance runners along that quest from the swamp to the stars. And when he, broken, bloated, lost, and in so many other ways injured and wounded, can still look up with us with that boyish look in his eyes and sing the most soaring notes that are full of the angels and demons in his soul, it tells you that the story is not yet written and that we're on a long haul here and we're all part of it. And when you look into his eyes, you ask yourself, what am I doing on this long run and what role can I play to make it better?
Eugene Jarecki. The movie is called The King. It's playing around the country. It opens in South Florida on Friday. You can find out more about it at theking.film. And I guess we can follow you on Twitter as well, at Eugene Jarecki. Thank you so much for talking with us. I enjoy your work so much. I'm a big fan, and it's really an honor to have you here.
Same here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Take care.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Eugene Jarecki. There you go. The movie, the film, The King, is playing now in most cities around the country. And with that, we are out of time. So I'll just tell you, we'll be back tomorrow with Howie Klein, because it's Thursday. Lots to talk about. Thank you for listening, everyone. Hope that wasn't too far out in left field, but we need a break from just straight politics every now and then, you know? All right. I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks for listening, everyone. Talk to you then.